street girl, and I'm here to save the world. You can't stop me, cause I'm impossible. There is nothing I can't do, and when things are cautious, know that I am on my way.
So what's this?
Hey everyone, this is SprayFM101, and I'm here tonight to review the live-action Kim Possible movie. Now, I have been a fan of Kim Possible since I was a wee lad. That's Scottish for little boy. And I've watched this show so much. Like, I just remember all the great times I had with Kim Possible growing up. I absolutely love the show. I've been going through it recently because, you know, memories, nostalgia. And, you know, it's great. So it's just wonderful. But it always has been, so, yeah. And I was, like, at first when that terrible garbage called Freaky Friday 2018 came out. When I saw that ad for the Kim Possible movie, I was hyped up. And then, when I saw the first trailer, it was awful. And due to the rest of the trailers they were putting out, I was expecting this to be the biggest piece of crap that Disney has made. Probably right up there with Freaky Friday 2018. But I watched the movie live, watched it on Disney Channel, sat in the living room, watched it on the big screen, living room television, and I have to say, this film wasn't bad. Matter of fact, it was actually pretty good. And this is coming from, like, my professional standpoint, my Disney fan standpoint, my Kim Possible fan standpoint, and just a general standpoint. I'm gonna go out my way and say that I really like this movie. Now, is it perfect? No. Does it do everything right? No. Although it does get a lot of things right, surprisingly. But the film was actually pretty good. Now, I'm going to go into the negatives first, and then go into the positives, because I have a lot more positives than negatives. And sorry, I keep looking at the screen. There are just too many ads that are catching my attention. Hold on a second. Okay, turn it off. Now there are no distractions. So, the bad. There were multiple times where they tried to modernize this film. Where they tried to modernize Kim Possible, should I say. By, you know, putting in, like, I think it was Villainous Gram. It was like a spin on Instagram. And you had Draken, like, doing, like, taking pictures on Villainstagram and saying, "Ooh, duck face!" And I'm like, oh, God, no, 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 no. Don't do what Dive Wimpy Kid the Long Haul did, please. I mean, like, I just hate it when, you know, people try to modernize old properties to try to make them relatable. I'll give you a hashtag. Hashtag can't relate. So, yeah. There were times where the CGI was actually really good, but there were times, like, You thought you saw some bad CGI scenes in the trailers? There are some, like, those shots you see in those trailers, that CGI is bad. But there are a couple more in here that are like, But, yeah, do I have any other problems with it? Oh, yeah. Ron. Now, Ron was fine in this movie. You know, he kind of captured the essence of Ron from the show, but my only problem is that he was played as the bumbling idiot, like the likable bumbling idiot. Now, if you watch the Kim Possible TV show, and if you haven't, what have you done with your childhood? I mean, seriously. If there are any kids watching this video, then I get it. I understand. Just go to Disney now, and you can experience the greatness that is the Kim Possible TV show. But if there are, like, hardcore Kim Possible fans watching this, then you already know how Ron's character is, you know? Like, he has his bumbling moments, but, like, when it's time for him to get serious, he gets serious. And, you know, I never felt like he had a moment where he got serious in this movie, you know? And, you know, I felt like that was a missed opportunity. Now, going into the positives, which are a lot. Now, I forget the actress's name that played Kim Possible. I'm going to look it up right now. Hold on a second. All this is getting cut out, by the way. Sadie Stanley. She was a very good Kim Possible. I really felt like she had the essence of, you know, the Kim Possible that we all know and love. You know, like that cool girl that can beat some behind and at the same time, you know, have that same, like, teenager-like attitude. I really liked that about, you know, how she acted like the character. And I thought that was really spot on. Everyone else in the movie was really good as well. The new additions were good. The new character that was added on, like, I forget her name, but, you know, she was surprisingly good as well, because when I saw her, I was like, wait a minute, who is that? Like, she wasn't from the show. But then, like, when I watched the movie, I was like, okay, and what her purpose was, and I was like, okay, all right, I see what they're going for. I got you, Disney. I got you. And, you know, I feel like every character in the film was really well handled. Even, like, the kid behind the desk that's played by the kid from Raven's Home. We don't talk about Raven's Home, by the way. That show was trash. A disgrace to That So Raven. But he was good in it too. And, you know, I felt like when I was watching the movie, like, I felt like there was a lot of love put into it. Like, you could tell, like you can tell when you're watching a movie, you could tell, or when you're watching anything, you could tell when there's love put into it. I feel like there was a lot of love put into this movie. Like, it wasn't, and there were a lot of nostalgic moments too. It wasn't like just when they played the original theme song and a live action variation of the opening at the beginning of the movie. It wasn't just that, although that was awesome. Thank you for that, Disney. And it wasn't like some, like, some girl is doing like a remix. No, they play like the actual theme song. That was awesome. And, you know, once again, thank you for that, Disney. They had just the smallest details as well. When there's a scene where she was talking to, and this is not a spoiler, by the way, where she was talking to the kid behind the desk, and I forget his name, and, you know, she says, please and thank you. Now, if you've watched the show, you know that, you know, she said, that's like one of her common catchphrases, right next to what's the sitch. And I really like that they added that into this movie, because it shows that they're putting in even the most minute details. And, you know, I really, when there's a scene where she was talking to, and this is not a spoiler, by the way, where she was talking to the kid behind the desk, and I forget his name, and, you know, she says, please and thank you. Now, if you've watched the show, you know that, you know, she said, that's like one of her common catchphrases, right next to what's the sitch. And I really like that they added that into this movie, because it shows that they're putting in even the most minute details. And, you know, I really like that. The villains, Shigo and Draken, were very well handled. Now, Shigo, she wasn't green, but, you know, it's okay because, you know, the performance was definitely Shigo. You could tell right away. Draken was perfect. Like, from how he acted to, like, even how he looks, because, like, even though he's supposed to be blue, like, you, like, forget about it when you're watching the movie because, you know, like, how the person that's playing him is acting is Draken. So you can accept it. Patton Oswalt as, my goodness, why? Why am I forgetting these names? Hold on a second. Professor Dementor. He was really good. He had a small part, but he was still really good. Bottom line, all the performances are great because, you know, they really catch, like, all the themes of all the characters that they play. And that's what I think is really important. And, you know, going back to the nostalgia thing, there's even an Easter egg. I'm not going to tell you what it is because, you know, it's a major Easter egg. But I was so happy when they showed that because I was like, oh my God. Yes. Like, it was so good. Like, I can't believe how good this movie turned out to be. Because I was expecting this movie to be a disaster. But it turns out, it was actually really good. And I'm not gonna lie, this movie shocked me. I mean, I should have had my optimism high because it's Disney. And Disney always delivers. I should know this. But, you know, the fact that they delivered to this level and the fact that they, you know, did the franchise justice. I will say it right now, they did the franchise justice. In my eyes, they did it justice. And, to be honest, I couldn't have asked for anything more. So, out of 10, I'm going to give Kim Possible 2019... an 8 out of 10. Only because of those minor issues that I pointed out at the beginning. I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10. Because, like, it wasn't nearly as bad as I thought it was going to be. It wasn't bad at all, I'll say. You know, it had some issues. It had some glaring flaws. But it wasn't bad to me. And, you know, that's really all I could ask for. That's really all I could ask for. Because I was so worried for this movie, and it turns out I didn't have any reason to be worried at all. So, yeah. Let me know in the comments down below, did you like this movie, or did you hate this movie? Is this the new Descendants 1 and 2 for you, or is this the new Freaky Friday 2018 to you? Has this done justice to the franchise, or has this spat in the face of the franchise? Let me know your thoughts in the comments down below. And I'm SpideyFan101 saying peace.